بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبا القاسم محمد. طب القلوب ودوائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها، وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الصادقين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يقول الله في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا وأن الله على نصرهم لقدير. First of our loud الصلوات for the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Second, with even louder voices, for the love of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. Third, with your loudest voices, for the love of Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. Once again, there's a request for a push forward. If one more time, if this is just a push. Salla ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The concept of freedom of speech is one of the most vital concepts in the life of any human being, in that that particular human being is able to understand and express his opinions to a wide variety of people. One notices that virtually every community in history has seen freedom of speech as being of the utmost importance in their development. So one notices, for example, that the more freedom of speech within a community, the more you're going to see a wide variety of an expression of one's opinion, and what is known as a society which is a liberated society, allowing mankind to understand the views of others. Indeed, with freedom of speech, a person can shake the whole world. Because when a person uses freedom of speech in its correct manner, one notices how we can shake people into actually re-evaluating their thoughts. The question is that the human being may maintain what is known as prejudice. And the idea of prejudice is that a person maintains a set of beliefs, continues within those beliefs, but in some cases never re-evaluates those beliefs. And that's why there is always a conundrum between what is freedom of thought and what is freedom of belief, with the idea that a freedom of belief does not necessarily mean there is a freedom of thought. As an example, in history one notices that any community where leaders have spoken out against injustice has always been a community full of success. One looks at America only 40-50 years ago and notices one particular feature, and that was that the black person was seen as being a slave, and even the black person took it within himself that he was seen in a slave mentality. What then happened was a rise of a set of speakers who used the freedom of speech, even if it wasn't there, they used it and they actually built the world of freedom of speech. People such as Martin Luther King came out with arguably one of the most famous speeches given in the history of mankind to change the whole ethos of American society. To the extent that Mrs. Condoleezza Rice is able to sit in Congress, and that you have someone like all the great basketball players all originating, whether it be Mr. Johnson or Mr. Jordan or Mr. Bryant and whatever their names are these days, you see them all originating from a particular area that maybe 30-40 years ago they were never allowed to emerge in. Indeed, with people like Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, the idea was the more we speak out against injustice, even if it means the shedding of our blood, it does not matter. As long as mankind is able to move forward in his life, that is all that is important for us. Hence one notices, for example, even people like Nelson Mandela. Where Nelson Mandela comes out of prison after 30 years in South Africa, he is flocked not only by black Africans, but by white Africans, not only by white Africans. Wherever he goes in the world, the first person any film star wants to meet is Nelson Mandela. And I've seen many film stars who themselves are seen as being extremely famous. They say just touching Nelson Mandela's hand was an honor for us. Because to them, here was a man who had the principle of using the gift of speech in the most appropriate appropriate way. And therefore he changed the whole face of one of the biggest countries one will ever see. And subhanAllah, it was ironic that when I recited my Muharram lectures 2 years ago in South Africa, the community that I had gone to there actually all came towards the path of Ahlul Bayt through Imam al-Khomeini. Imagine that these people had come towards the path of Ahlul Bayt in the middle of Africa. You know, as Shia, sometimes we only think Islam is in the Middle East. Lebanon, Iraq, Iran, a couple other countries here, left, right, center. No one knows what's going on elsewhere. If you tell him, go and give da'wah there, he'll tell you, what do you mean? There's no Muslims there, there's no Shia there. Whereas you realize when you go South Africa, they told me that many people had come towards the path of Ahlul Bayt in South Africa because of Imam al-Khomeini. Because as you know, in 1980 till 1988, you had the Iraq-Iran war. And what happened was, in that period, you had apartheid, when the black people were being oppressed. What happened was that the apartheid regime said to Imam al-Khomeini, they said to him, we will give you arms in exchange for oil. And then Imam al-Khomeini replied by saying, us the Shia do not do deals with racist countries. Suddenly you had all these African people asking, who's the Shia? We've only been accustomed to one particular school, which has been flogged from you know where. They are the ones who have come and told us what Islam is. And they said, suddenly we heard the word Shia. When we asked these people, what is Shia? They said to us, oh Shia, Khomeini, these are all Zionist kafirs. You don't want to come near them. They said, as soon as they said that to us, straight away we all became Shia. Because what they found is that whatever these lot have been teaching, we'll do the exact opposite. And that's why you find that when a leader uses freedom of speech, he can change the whole course of history. And that's why our community leaders need to use the freedom of speech in the most appropriate way. Not by bashing someone and telling them that they will burn in hell, nor by being aloof from the people, but rather by being within the people. Rather, they have to come and they have to speak out whenever they see injustice. Indeed, freedom of speech is virtually within every legal system in the world today. You go to Britain, you see you have laws in discrimination cases. What's a discrimination case other than putting boundaries around what you can say and what you can't say? Or even those of you who've studied law will know the law of libel. The law of libel is when a person comes forward and he says something which is seen as being obscene against that particular person. And also you find the law of treason in the UK. And the law of treason is when someone, for example, speaks out against the Queen. But even in the UK, those of you who have been to London, many of you may have been to Hyde Park. And if you've been to Hyde Park, in Hyde Park there is what is known as Speaker's Corner. Imagine that in this country, which is a non-Islamic country, they give more expression of speech than our own countries do. In some cases, our own countries, Islamic countries, we have to remain quiet. And sometimes that's the point why we are backward and why they are forward. Because while they allow everyone to have their freedom of speech, we will shut anyone who doesn't agree with our opinion. But one notices that in the world of law, there have been many changes recently to the boundaries of freedom of speech. And one particular event rocked this, and that was when Salman Rushdie came forward in 1989 and he wrote the book, The Satanic Verses. Imagine calling a book The Satanic Verses. You're not really trying to tell someone to endear them towards that book. But of course, Rushdie in his character is a person of little respect. One notices in that book, he brings the name of the Prophet Muhammad, he brings the name of Aisha, he brings the name of Salman al-Farisi, and mentions them in the most obscene of ways, most obscene of languages. And they came forward, and therefore many people began to review that Rushdie has written a book about the Prophet Muhammad where he is blasphemous against the Prophet Muhammad. Rushdie replied simply by saying that within freedom of speech should be the freedom to offend. I should have the right to offend. You're telling me I've got freedom of speech. Within freedom of speech, I should be offensive. I want to be offensive to Muhammad. I've taken all my ahadith from Bukhari and Muslim. And in Bukhari and Muslim, in some cases, there are ahadith which are more offensive to Rasulullah than what anyone else can say outside the religion of Islam. Here it rocked the boat, and what happened was, only a few years later, you had the famous writer about the Holocaust called Irving. And when Irving wrote his book about the Holocaust, denying certain areas about the Holocaust, you found straight away every Goldman, Goldberg, Goldstein, they all suddenly came, and they started replying back to him by saying, this is unacceptable. While we, of course, agree that it's unacceptable for a person to come forward and say that a tragedy never occurred and that oppression should have continued. We disagree. We of course agree that oppression should never occur. But on the other hand, if you are saying Rushdie can have freedom of speech in coming forward and being blasphemous against the Prophet Muhammad, then what is wrong with Irving writing about the Holocaust? In both cases, the principle has to be set that there is what is known as freedom of speech, but then there is also freedom to offend. And freedom of being offensive is one of the worst things. But the West has put it under intellectual criticism. When a Western person writes a book which is controversial, they don't say, no, it's controversial. They say, this is intellectual criticism. This is seeing something from a different angle. And therefore, what you find is that many people have continued to